of us today and being able to meet with you all, greet you all, and to partake of the food, the enjoyment, and fellowship together one with another. You know, brethren, when we talk to people in the denominational world, one of the biggest problems that we have in dealing with some of them is the difference in the Old Testament and the New Testament. As a matter of fact, we talk to people from time to time, and they say, "Oh, y'all are the ones that don't believe in the Old Bible, do you? And, or you don't believe in the Old Testament, do you?" And so we have to spend a little time helping them to understand the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. God has, from eternity, had a plan for the redemption of humanity. In Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 3, Paul writes, "How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby, when ye read, ye now understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, was this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Christ Jesus, to the intent that now under the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord." Again, in Titus 1 and verse 2, Paul writes, "In hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began." The Apostle Peter also says something about this in 1 Peter 1 and verse 20, when he said, "Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you." Friends, it is obvious, it should be obvious to us from the Scripture, that Judaism was never intended to be God's final revelation or covenant with humanity. In Romans chapter 7, verses 6 and 7, Paul writes, "But now we are delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit, and not in the oldness of the letter. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law, for I had not known lust except the law had said, Thou shalt not covet." Again, in 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 11, Paul writes, "For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious." And then in Ephesians 2 and 15, Paul writes, "Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments containing ordinances, for to making himself of twain one new man, so making peace." And Colossians 2:14, "Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, taking it out of the way, and nailing it to his cross." With those thoughts in mind, I want to turn to Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8, starting at verse 8, discussing the new covenant. Hebrews 8, beginning in verse 8 and going down through the end of the chapter. "For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers, in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I'll put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith, A new covenant, he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away." In short, the new covenant was designed to replace the entire religious system of the Jews, including the Decalogue, that's the Ten Commandments, the priesthood, the sacrifices, the tabernacle ritual, the temple services that later developed, the statutes, the judgments, embracing the entire ceremonial and moral constitution of Judaism. Every aspect of Judaism was to be done away. It was never the plan of God that the old covenant, the law of Moses, would continue on down through the stream of time, even to this present day. That was not the plan of God. And every student of the Bible needs to identify which covenant it is that was annulled and replaced by the new. The text of Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34, which is the prophecy of Jeremiah concerning this new covenant, which the writer of Hebrews quotes in Hebrews chapter 8, beginning at verse 8, going down through verse 13, foretells of another covenant coming after Judaism, a covenant between God and humanity, which the writer of the book of Hebrews confirms is the new covenant. Hebrews 8, beginning at verse 6. Wycliffe records, and I quote, "The concept of the new covenant is Jeremiah's most important contribution to biblical thought," unquote. What we want to do this afternoon for a few minutes is to look at Hebrews chapter 8 and the remainder of that chapter, starting at verse 8, and also Jeremiah 31, 31 to 34, and look at it as carefully as possible and see exactly what the writer is telling us. In Jeremiah 31 and 31, he says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. The covenant which the Lord will make with all of Israel in the future is called a new covenant. It is a new covenant as compared with that which the fathers made with God at Mount Sinai when the people had been led out of the land of Egypt. They came to the foot of Sinai, and thus it is implicitly called the old covenant. And there was more to that covenant that God gave to Moses at Sinai, with more than simply the Ten Commandments. In Deuteronomy 29 and verse 1, the Bible says, these are the words of the covenant which the Lord commanded Moses to make with the children of Israel in the land of Moab, beside the covenant which he made with them in Horeb." There are those today who contend that there is a difference between the Ten Commandments and the rest of the law. The fact is, the Bible lets us know that the Ten Commandments and all that God gave was part of the law of Moses. It all went together. Adam Clark, the commentator, simply identifies the new covenant as the Christian dispensation. When Jeremiah wrote his prophecy concerning the coming of a new covenant, the Israelites had long since divided into two nations. Israel was in the north and Judah in the south. So that the reference to the house of Israel and the house of Judah was used to include all Israelites in that expression. In fulfillment, though, the reference was to the new Israel of God, the church. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 16, as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them and mercy and upon the Israel of God. When in the New Testament the Apostle Paul is referring to the Israel of God, he is referring to the New Testament church, the church of our Lord that was established in Jerusalem, first Pentecost, after the resurrection of Christ, as set forth in Acts chapter 2. The new Israel of God is comprised of people from all races, all nations, all stations in life, both genders. In Galatians 3 and verse 28, Paul says, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus." In the new covenant, all special considerations and privileges of racial Israel were forever lost, forever gone. Race today, by the way, Jew and Gentile, those are the races of men. Race today is totally unimportant as it regards the salvation of man. No person, whosoever he or she may be, can be saved or lost eternally upon the basis of any racial consideration whatsoever. In Jeremiah 31 and verse 32, the passage goes on, "Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. Israel did not only strain the covenant of God, they broke the covenant of God. Furthermore, there were not any of the promises of that covenant which were designed to be valid unless Israel refrained from the breaking of the covenant. So when they broke the covenant, God's promises to them for their time were to be no more. The promise of the land, they got the land, but they broke the covenant and they lost the land. God compared the covenant relationship between himself and Israel to that of a marriage. For example, in Jeremiah 3 and verse 14, the Bible says, "Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you, and I will take you one of a city and two of a family, and I will bring you to Zion." God says this is like a marriage relationship between himself and the people of Israel. In Hosea chapter 2, verses 7 and 8, we see how that Israel departed from the way of the Lord. He says, "And she shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them, and she shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for then was it better with me than now. For she did not know that I gave her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal." God blessed Israel. God gave them everything that anyone could ever give the people of Israel, and they took what God gave them and they used it for other gods that were made by men. The Israelites thus became guilty of spiritual adultery. They broke the covenant of God. In Jeremiah 31 and verse 33, "But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people." Now the new covenant prophesied here contrasts with the covenant written initially on tables of stone. He's talking about that which was given to the people of Israel, Judaism, beginning with the Ten Commandments and continuing with the commandments that God gave to Moses and to give to Israel. In Exodus 31 and verse 18, "And he gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, two tables of testimony, tables of stone written with the finger of God," in Deuteronomy 4 and 13. "And he declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even 10 commandments, and he wrote them upon two tables of stone," in Deuteronomy 9 and verse 11. "And it came to pass at the end of 40 days and 40 nights that the Lord gave me the two tablets of stone, even the tables of the covenant." And in chapter 10 and verse 4, "And he wrote on the tables, according to the first writing, the 10 commandments, which the Lord spake unto you in the mount, out of the midst of the fire in the day of the assembly, and the Lord gave them unto me." The Apostle Paul contrasted Judaism and Christianity by contrasting the tables of stone with the fleshly tables of the heart. 2 Corinthians 3 and 3. He said, "For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart." What a contrast there is then between that old covenant and the new covenant of Christ. The difference between the two covenants consists really in this, that the will of God as expressed in the law under the old covenant was presented externally to the people, while under the new covenant it is to become an internal principle of life. And we're going to be talking about that in the further process of this lesson. In Jeremiah 31 and 34, "And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." That is a dramatic and powerful powerful statement, prophecy and promise given by God through Jeremiah to the people of Israel. The first half of verse 34 distinguishes who and how and when souls became members of the old covenant versus souls becoming members of the new covenant. Now, infants and small children were members of the old covenant of Israel. But this would no longer be true under the new covenant of our Lord. Every member of the new covenant Israel will know God, he says. In other words, the word know in Hebrew has the connotation of knowledge derived from personal experience. The idea is that one will know God because he has come to understand God. He has come to know the will of God. He is convicted. He is convinced. He is, by his own desire, seeking God, and of his own will, of his own volition, voluntarily bringing himself in under the commandment of the Lord and into that covenant relationship with him. Under the new covenant of Christ, men are taught before they become Christians. Then they obey the gospel of Christ. Under the old covenant, a child was a Jew just as soon as he or she was born. And then as they grew and developed physically and mentally, they had to be taught this fact. Now, son, you're an Israelite. You're a Jew. And you were born that way because daddy and mama are Jews. And here is what you must know as a Jew. Here is what the Ten Commandments said. Here is the rest of the law. Here is everything that we must know and do and everything that we must follow. He didn't have a choice about it. He was born into it from a physical standpoint. They got me when I was born, and that's just the way it is. Rather than receiving their religion merely by inheritance, as under the old covenant, under the new covenant, religion was to be personally embraced on the front end of the covenant relationship. I want to learn of God. I study the Word of God. I come to know that God loves me, that Christ went to the cross and sacrificed himself and shed his blood on the cross of Calvary for my sin. I am convicted of sin. I repent out of godly sorrow for sin and turn my life around. I confess the name of Christ and I'm baptized under the remission of sin. I do it voluntarily. I do it because I want to do it. I know what I'm doing and I wasn't born into it physically. It's my personal choice. That's what he means when he says, they shall all know me from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. Forgiveness of sin is the mission of the new covenant. Forgiveness of sin is the mission of the new covenant. And that materially differs from the purpose of the old covenant. The key contrast between the Old Testament and the New Testament is expressed quite well by Kylan Davis, the commentator for the Old Testament, who said, if the old covenant can only awaken mankind to the perception of sin, but cannot blot it out, end quote. And I think that's a very good analysis of the contrast between the old and the new. The purpose of the old, it gave to mankind the perception of sin, the understanding of sin, the reality of sin, the depravity of sin, but it couldn't blot sin out. We go to the New Testament, Romans 7, verses 12 and 13, and Paul says, wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just and good. Talking about the law of Moses. Was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. What is Paul saying? Somebody says, I don't quite get it. Well, Paul is simply telling us that by looking at and striving to follow the law of Moses, people came to an understanding that sin is the most terrible thing in the world. That sin, in fact, does separate one from God, that one needs God, one needs a Savior, one needs forgiveness of sins, but he couldn't get it under the law of Moses in a full and complete way whatsoever. There was always a remembrance of sins that were not forgiven under the old covenant. In Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 1, the inspired writer says the following: "For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offer year by year, continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sins every year, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins." Well, that very well sums up what was wrong with the law of Moses. And yet somebody says, but God gave it to them. That's right. God gave it. It was good. And it had a purpose. Its purpose was to help them realize the exceeding sinfulness of sin, and that man by himself cannot save himself. Man needs a Savior. And thus it pointed unto Jesus Christ. He says very clearly that if the animal sacrifices under the law of Moses could bring us to salvation fully and completely, then after we had offered one sacrifice of the animal, we ought to no longer have to offer the animal sacrifices anymore. But because year by year continually we have to offer the animal sacrifices, it is abundantly clear to us that there is not forgiveness of sins once and for all. Thus, the need for the perfect lamb, the perfect sacrifice through Jesus Christ, the Son of God. But what do the scriptures have to say about this new covenant? The new covenant is the New Testament validated not with the blood of animals, but with the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. This was Paul's message to the brethren at Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 25. Notice what he said: "After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." Notice the emphasis Jesus made on the new covenant, on the blood, and upon himself. This cup, that is the fruit of the vine, the contents. The fruit of the vine is the New Testament in my blood. Well, in contrast to what? In contrast to the blood of bulls and goats under the law of Moses. It is a bringing in of a new covenant of the Lord. Notice what else he says in Matthew 26 and 28. "For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many." For what purpose, Lord? For the remission of sins. We commemorate the blood of Jesus for the New Testament in the weekly communion, in the Lord's Supper, in Luke 22 and verse 20. "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you." Again, we see the emphasis our Lord is making, the great contrast between what he is doing, what his blood can and will do, compared and contrasted with the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of the heifer sprinkled in the Old Testament days. In Acts 20 and verse 7, the Bible tells us on the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. On the first day of the week, the brethren came together to worship God. What are the purposes of their worshiping God on the first day of the week, the Lord's day? It was to break bread. That is, they were observing the Lord's Supper. And every first day of the week, Christians around the world partake of the unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine in memory of the great sacrifice that our Lord made on the cross, because his sacrifice is a sacrifice, as was earlier mentioned by Brother Andrew, once and for all, the great sacrifice. The new covenant is the tool by which sins are actually forgiven once and for all. The writer of Hebrews mentions Jeremiah 31, 31 to 34, not only in Hebrews chapter 8, verses 6 through 13, but also in Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 16. Notice what he says: This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. These statements are highly significant. People today need to understand the beauty, the greatness, and the glory that has taken place through the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. Notice what the death of our Lord has done in the sacrifice. There is remission of sins. There is thus no more need for an offering for sin, because the sin offering has been made one time for all time for mankind. And as a result of that, we have the opportunity to enter before our Lord in boldness. Notice what he says. Only through the implementation of the new covenant can the child of God have boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Hebrews 10 and verse 19. Whereas the old covenant, not having a provision for saving sinful humanity, only condemned, only brought about the awareness of sin. The new covenant offers spiritual life, not death, not condemnation, but life. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning in verse 6, Paul writes, as he contrasts the old with the new, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in stone, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. He's letting us know that the law that God gave to Israel was a glorious law. But it is as far been superseded by the greater glory, the more glory of the New Testament of Jesus Christ. That's what we need to get across to our denominational friends when they ask that question, oh, y'all don't believe in the Old Testament? Well, yes, we believe in the Old Testament. It was written aforetime for our learning, Romans 15 and verse 4, but it is not our law today. Why? Because the New Testament is more glorious. God didn't intend for the law of Moses to continue as a law to the end of time. We need to always point that out. The forgiveness of sins is the grand hallmark of the new covenant. Never before in the history of mankind was anything ever seen like the New Testament. There is a fundamental difference between the old covenant and the new covenant regarding how one becomes a member of the respective covenants, how one gets into the covenant relationship. The part of Jeremiah 31, verse 34, that reads, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord, pertains to the differing manners of becoming a member of either covenant. Under Judaism, as we mentioned earlier, children were born into the covenant, not choosing for themselves to become covenant members. However, under Christianity, rather than being born into the covenant by physical birth, souls are taught the New Testament, the gospel of our Lord, after which they voluntarily bind themselves or voluntarily submit themselves as bond servants, as slaves of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's done through a conscious effort. I'm a child of God because I chose to be a child of God. They didn't get me when I was a baby. I studied, I learned, I understood, I wanted That's the difference in the old and the new. In John 6 and verse 45, Jesus said, "It is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught of God. Every man therefore that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh unto me." Jesus tells us that one comes to him, one comes to salvation, one binds himself to the new covenant and in that covenant relationship by hearing, by learning, by being taught. That's how it happened. It's an intelligent process. In John 3, verses 3 and 7, when Jesus was speaking with Nicodemus, the ruler of the Jews, he said, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Marvel not that I..."